Miigwan, stema, Scots Nyunga, Matsitan. Aha. Thank you. Yuxan.
Yeah.
That's all. I'll just start now. Sit good. Down. Have a seat. Where are the markers? Nigan, Katam Scott Nogakio. Utoga, Mamsku Mato Napil, Danskutapa Nemusuma. Papa still gives with the Danskutapa Nemusum. Utego was a scanes together. A gum seepy. Ego teot sa kisupuhteok. Osaamme igimas nahari gui huunuao. Ette go saamme osaam uhtsiigin toihtaakki kankir. Ai siinu aga aski kan mette kaiait. Agam siipi go muuta. En askum naa. Epe taguhteegi epe kugwe. Ette go kiskino hamasuek tani kan mut siis tan suma kista nota ke tan skuta panno gigi igi ai speaks ku te gigi ai speaks ku te tan sigi igi ai sa patita tik mstegi gwe moy gikskete no tan sana masneke on taps ku suma ego mu ngatipu tena nots I greet you all, and I honor each and every one of you and your lives, your holistic lives. I honor that, and that you're here. The old people would say that from the time of the zepto second before the Big Bang theory, 13.7 billion years ago or so, there was a zepto second, and all of us were considered in the thought of that divinity, that we would be here at I got to check my time here, 6:50 p.m. and we would all be here in this room. It was thought of those billions of years ago, and so there's a lot of things that. That go along with the world view that Turtle Islanders have. Specifically, what I can talk to is about Nehio life. I need to close this door because I'm... Uh-oh. So when the... When there was... acknowledgement of the peoples. The first people that came down the St. Lawrence River, I think that's the one anyways, I'm not too good with my geography. They came upon some Nehio people like myself, my language group, and they came in these big wooden boats, and we call those people with the hairy faces and the wooden boats, Mistigusu Winok, the wooden boat people. And when they were greeted by the Turtle Islanders, they went like this, and collectively. And the French, the wooden boat people said, Le Cree. So that's one of the ways that we came to be known as Cree. I don't call myself a Cree. I don't call myself indigenous, First Nations, Indian, chuck wagon burner, prairie nigger, or any of those things. I call myself Nehio. That's the name I know myself as. So it's an honor when someone calls me by what I am, Nehio. I understand that part of this process might have to do with reconciliation, and part of that process towards reconciliation is honoring me in the way, and the rest of the Turtle Islanders in the way that we know each other. For instance, the people down south are known as Nichitapi, and most people know them as Blackfoot or Blackfeet, and the ones up north there, they call them Dog Rib, Slavey, Beaver, Chipuan, and they call themselves Diné. And there's a group like Calgary, outside of Calgary too, they call themselves Sutene, but most people call them Sarsi. So part of that reconciliation process is getting to understand ourselves by the names that we know ourselves as. There are, as far as pedagogy is concerned, before we get started here, who here is left-handed? Raise your hand. One left-handed person. The rest of us are a right-handed person. Except for the left-handed person, I'd like you to do this before we get started. Take your dominant hand and touch your non-dominant knee. Take your dominant hand, touch your non-dominant knee. If the left-handed person, take your left hand, touch your right knee. What that'll do is, it's a simple little exercise, and what that does is it works on the brain, because we're all, that's it. You don't have to hold it for too long unless you're getting stimulated. Oh, that feels good. There's nothing magical about it. The magic is in the way the brain works, in that there's a synapse that happens in the brain, and how we've been taught through the ages, and I don't see anyone younger than 20 in here, but how we've been taught is a certain way, and that thinking has to do with having learned a linear concept, which is from A to Z, for instance. It goes from left to right, and there's 26 symbols there, 26 letters or alphabets or syllabics, whatever you want to call them, that go from left to right, and that's linear in concept. And the methodology that we've used through Western pedagogy is an algorithmic methodology. The other thing that we've had to do as far as training the brain is concerned is learn through rote. So there's a couple of things. What I'm going to be discussing is quite different a paradigm from that mode of instruction. The methodology is heuristic, the learning is organic, and the system requires, rather than linear thinking, we do lateral thinking. So it's a bit of a different system as far as that's concerned. When we were put into residential schools, a lot of our system of language, we started out, I'm told, by people who have done research, that there were approximately 600,000 words in the Nehiyo language prior to contact. The Nehiyo people go from the Rocky Mountains across Canada into the United States, what's now the United States, all the way down to the East Coast. There were a group of people there that were driven to extinction, and their language system is gone as far as their dialect is concerned. They call them Peahtiginoak. When you anglicize Peahtiginoak, you anglicize it, it sounds like this, Beatuk. So those people were driven to extinction. And then you go down there, the Nehiyo language went down all the way down the eastern seaboard into Florida. There's a big river down there that we call it Mississippi. And when you anglicize that, it comes out Mississippi. And so the Nehiyo language, it's not far-fetched to say that that number, 600,000 words, is quite realistic. If you contrast it to the English language, which started out 10,000 years ago with 10,000 words, it has now gone to, I think it's, where's the librarians in here? It's gone now to almost 1 million words. For instance, 10,000 years ago, there was no word for acrimony, for instance. Pseudonym didn't exist back then. The English language has built up because of an expansion. The Nahio language has gone down because of its contraction and being put on, the people being put on small tracts of land, quite euphemistically referred to as reservations. And these people could not leave their collective reservations without the express written permission of an Indian agent who was usually a white man. So you can see how the language would then have dwindled down because there's no way for it except within its own confines to continue to grow. So the written language, a couple of the histories that I want to talk about there is that there is one historical perspective of the Nahio language, and that is that a man by the name of James Evans created our writing system so that he could change the so that he could interpret the Bible into our language, the Nahio language, and that was 200 years ago. The other popular belief is that a man by the name of Mistanaskuel had a vision about what I call spirit markers, and was able to develop a writing system for the Nahio people. There is another one, and that is that this was found at writing on stone on a rock, this spirit marker, and it was carbon dated to 10,000 years. When a people are conquered, we cannot write our own history. So this one here says that our writing system is minimally 10,000 years. When we were allowed our language back in 1951, I believe. Can you hear me with this thing? Okay. When we were allowed our language back in 1951, there was a legislation that allowed us to be able to use our language, although it wasn't made public. We were allowed to do our own services as far as our religious processes were concerned. But that was, like I said, that wasn't known public. I remember in 1963, I was 4 years old. I remember sneaking off to a Sundance with my family. I was 4 years old. And that's exactly what it felt like we were sneaking, because there was the Catholics on our reservation still had quite the stranglehold on the people's psyche. So there was still the mentality that these people could hold favor for certain people in their court. Although by then it was largely non-existent. The mentality of the group people on the whole was still that there was this group of people, white people, that had power over the people on the reservations. In 1971, where I come from in the St. Paul area, there's a school there called Blue Quills Indian Residential School. The people that had been running the school there, the priest and the nuns that had been running the school, left a year earlier, and we were given the opportunity to then bring back our own educators. When these people came and taught us, they taught us a system that was completely different than what we had been learning, and completely different in many ways. And one of the ways is that the articulation required for to speak some of the, to make some of the sounds in the Nahuatl language is completely different than from any European language, irrespective of diphthongs. When we learned about this, we learned about directions. That's the first one. And we learned, as you know, if, when you go A to Z, A is at is the number one, Z is 26, H is whatever, 8 I think it is, and so on and so forth. There's an order to everything, much as this, like the system that we're learning here. And feel free to record whatever, and I've already given permission to our lovely lady there to record if you want to record. I'm okay with that. This is the first one, and this one makes the sound, a vowel sound. We have four vowel sounds, and those vowel sounds is ah, e, oo, e. This one goes ah, and it goes off into the east direction. It goes ah, ba, da, la. And it's a very horrible, I have horrible handwriting, just to warn you. Most horrible handwriting. What this says is ah, ba, da, la, is what it says. A lot of people here have a issue with this last one here, la, and they say we don't have la in our language. But it, this encompasses those other dialects that I speak about. For instance, if I were to say, let's see, I gotta pick the nicest woman here. If I were to say to you, I like you, I would say, kimi yoimitin, kimi yoimitin. A person with this dialect would say, kimi leimitin, kimi leimitin. And there'll be other syllabics there that'll encompass those other dialects. So this goes off in the east direction, ah, pa, ta, la. And of course, when I talk about the number four, then it, the philosophies that are within our worldview are also covered as there's the number four. In order to have life, we all need fire, source of heat. We need the earth, of course, and then we need a source of water. A water source, and we need air. So the four elements are included in that. A lot of people say the four directions. Well, that's what comes from the four directions. Is 4.5 billion years ago, our sun came into being, and then through all that turmoil, they call turmoil and chaos, the earth formed, and then there were comets that hit the earth, and there was water that came from the comets that were carrying ice and whatever, and then there was air that was formed a few hundred million years ago. That's the grandfather direction in the east. In the grandmother direction in the southeast is the vowel sound E, and this one goes mi, ki, ni, yi, si, ti, ri. It goes mi, ki, ni, yi, si, ti, ri. So it starts out ah, pa, ta, la, mi, ki, ni, yi, si, ti, ri. And there are seven, the number seven is very significant to the Nahuatl people, and for practical purposes, I'll just talk about your body, and you have two holes here, 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 and the seventh hole is here. Out of these two holes, I'm told, you hear two things. You hear truth and you hear bullshit. Out of these two holes, you see two things. You see good, you see bad. Out of these two holes, you sense two things, holy and evil. Out of this hole is what then our Creator gave us, and that is choice. So which in every given situation, we have that choice, what we're going to, how we're going to interpret our reality in the moment, which is basically what we have. In the south direction, again, is the vowel sound E, and this goes E, P, T, L. Again, there are four letters and that go off in that direction, E, P, T, L. And of course, in order to be a complete or an exact human being, we need a body, mind, emotions, and spirit. In the southwest direction is the vowel sound eh. This one goes me, ke, ne, ye, se, che, re. And there again we have the number 7 is very symbolic and significant. Someone was telling me that we have 7 tectonic plates on the earth. I don't know how accurate that is. Are there any geologists in here?
Sounds right.
So there's getting back to the heuristic methodology, again, all of these point to natural nature's teachings. In the west direction, we have the vowel sound oo, and it goes oo, poo, too, loo. And number 4 again there is very significant. And the number 4 for us, what we understand about is that there are levels of communication from the ethereal perspective. On a spiritual plane, there's 4 levels of communication. The first level of communication has to do with what we understand here. If spirit were to talk to you, you'd understand it with the words that it spoke, whether in a whisper or in a normal voice. At the second level of communication is that feeling that you get when you're walking someplace. I think all of us here were old enough to notice, but we when you're somewhere and you're feeling really creeped out, like something's watching you, and you're walking around, I've been told that that's actually the best place to be. It's a spirit trying to communicate with you. But because of our propensity towards fear and uncertainty, our immediate reaction is to get scared, get leery. So, but that's actually the best place to be, is in that place. Or else the second level of communication, and there's many other examples. I'll just give you a couple of examples of them. The other one is when you hear that high-pitched sound in your ear, either ear, it's a spirit trying to communicate with you or get in touch with your own psyche. And so that's, again, about communication. Then there's the third level of communication, and those are the sounds that we use in our ceremony. if any of you have been involved in a sweat lodge ceremony, chicken dance ceremony, sun dance ceremony, you will have heard some of those, what they call chanting. But for us, that's the third level of communication. And each one of those that we present, what they call songs that we present, has a particular dimension in the ethereal that it is assigned to. The fourth level of communication is love. These all have a law. Each of these has a law. The first law has to do with love, and that one is, that first law is that says sagihituk, sagihituk, love each and one another. That's a law for us. Now, if you look at the past and what our homes were, we lived in these what we call miigwaahpa or teepees. And if you go by someone's miigwaahpa, you can hear what they're saying. And as you all know, learning from Western culture, people who live in glass houses should not throw stones. People who live in teepees also need to appreciate and have a common value, that our common value was that first law that is associated with this particular spirit marker, sagihituk. Doesn't mean that it was all euphoria. I don't think any society is all euphoria. It's a romantic, notion, but it's not realistic to think that it was all euphoria. But these are the laws. That the second one is wichihituk. Wichihituk means help each and one another, help each other. So all these have all a bunch of laws, and you can go and do your research on that. In the northwest direction is the vowel sound oo again. Mu, ku, nu, yu, su, tu, ru. And what I'll do is I'll make another one like this over here after and put the Roman orthography there. So again, the number seven is very significant and symbolic and significant. Please excuse me for a second. Oh, I'm so glad you guys made it. Again, the number seven is very symbolic and significant, and there's so many reasons why the number seven, and they get a little more complicated. I'll only talk about the really simplistic virtues of the number seven. For instance, we all have seven directions: left, front, right, behind, below, above, and inside. And what I've been told is that in those seven directions exist these four things that we're born with, irrespective of our own judgments, our own developed values. And those four things are: there's love, it's amazing, full of wonder and full of beauty. So to your left, there's love, it's amazing, full of wonder, full of beauty. To your right, there's love, it's amazing, full of wonder, full of beauty. In front of you, there's love, it's amazing, full of wonder, full of beauty. To your left, there's love, it's amazing, full of wonder, full of beauty. Behind you, there's love, It's amazing, full of wonder, full of beauty. Below you, there's love. It's amazing, full of wonder, full of beauty. Above you, there's love. It's amazing, full of wonder, full of beauty. Inside you, there's love. It's amazing, full of wonder and full of beauty. So you have love, you're amazing, you're full of wonder, you're wonderful, you're full of beauty, you're beautiful. That's irrespective of your own opinion. And our opinions, of course, are made as we grow from children into adults, and the messages that we receive along the way. And some of those messages we take to heart, unfortunately. However, according to those teachings, irrespective of our own beliefs about ourselves, those four things exist. In the north direction is the vowel sound eh. I like to call this the anomaly. I've been asking about this one for so long. It goes eh, pe, te, le. Again, the number four is very significant and symbolic. And there are four phases of time that I'm told about from that time the name of our God is Ie, is what we, a lot of, you'll hear, you go into ceremony, you'll hear, you go into the backwoods over there, into the ceremonies, and you'll hear the old people, the men and women, they'll begin to pray, they'll say, Ai, Kisemanito. A lot of people think that the name for our God is Kisemanito. Kisemanito means, Kise is a kind, protective, kind and protective. Manitu is a creator, kind, protective creator. Ai is the name for our God, our divinity. So, and coincidentally, in East and South, we have those as well. So, there are four phases of time. There's the past, the present, the future, and eternity. In the northeast direction is the vowel sound ah. It goes ma, ka, na, ya, sa, cha, ra. So it goes, starts out. By the way, this is supposed to be symmetrical. I wasn't lying to you when I said that I have horrible handwriting. This should look exactly like this mirror. This in the diagonal should look like that. As you can see, my penmanship is not the best. So it goes, ah, pa, ta, la, mi, ki, ni, yi, si, chi, ri, e, pi, ti, li, me, ke, ne, ye, se, che, re, u, pu, tu, lu, mu, ku, nu, yu, su, chu, ru, e, pe, te, le, ma, ka, na, ya, sa, cha, ra. Those are the major spirit markers. There's four of in each grandfather direction, and there's 16 of them in all. When we look at this in the abstract, we see a square, and in this square, it's related to our holiest of holy places, what is we call the Thirst Dance Lodge. Now, when the Thirst Dance Lodge was first seen by Europeans, they wanted to know what the people were doing, and they saw that the people were looking up as if they were looking up at the sun, and they called it a sun dance. So it's quite erroneous that label, sun dance, it's actually a thirst dance lodge, and people go in there to martyr themselves and to suffer on behalf of their loved ones and fulfill their commitments. And this is one of the symbols that you'll see in the holiest of holy places in the sun dance. It has a very impactful and significant is a significant part of that ceremony here. So, and in each of these, 16 becomes very significant as well. When a person is obligated to put up that thirst dance ceremony or sun dance, or I'll just start saying sun dance ceremony, they're obligated to do that for 16 years. And each session that they have in a given year is considered a yearly cycle, although it's a seasonal cycle. So 16 is very important as well. There is another one. Oh, the last one, the item number 7 is important, symbolic and significance. Let's see, I'll start going. What kind of music do you listen to? Quickly, yes.
Anything, rock.
Okay, please don't answer anything. Just be specific. Okay, rock?
Pop.
Pop?
Metal?
Blues?
Power.
We'll get back to you.
A lot of soul?
Soul?
Jazz,
okay. So those ones there, they've the music that you were talking about, except for, I'll get back to you, fits into the scheme. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. The music this gentleman is talking about fits into this one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now, when Hollywood wanted to fit our music into the scheme that you're talking about, of course, country and western was part of that, they would come out and they would start with, they try to fit so hard to fit that 7 beats into that 4 beats, and this is how it sounded. And it became somewhat of a stereotypical model of our music, and you can understand why. Now, so the number 7 again is very important. Every 4 times 7 is what? 4 times 7, yes. Over here, 4 times 7. Yeah, if I'm not pointing at you, don't say anything. I'm still working on that model there. You weren't here for that. So, it's about, again, working the brain. 4 times 7, of course, is 28. Thank you. And every 28 days there is a lunar cycle, and there's a full moon. And we call each of those full moons, we call them grandmother. And this happens 13 times a year that there's a full moon. Not by coincidence, also there's an animal, a person I like to call, but most people call it an animal, and which this island is named after. And that's the turtle. We call this Turtle Island. If any of you have a chance to go see a real, 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 real turtle, you'll see that it has 13 markings on the back. And it's not by coincidence that those 13 markings are also the number of full moons that we have in a year. Again, going back to that heuristic methodology and organic learning. Every 28 days that happens, there's a full moon, and we call those ones grandmothers. every 28 days, a woman has her cycle on average, I'm told. I don't know, I'm not a woman, so I don't know that. But the ladies here can correct me if I'm wrong, but on average, that's what I'm told. There are 28 bones in your feet. Again, same number of grandmother directions. So the number 28 is very symbolic and significant. When a woman is on her cycle, we say, iyotihtigut, means they're visiting her. She has visitors. A lot of women will say, iyokumit, she's having grandmothers. And what are those grandmothers? It's those 13 moons. And when I began this talk, I was telling you that it's slightly different than from what we've learned through Western ideology and Western concepts. When there's a creation story that comes from the other island, and in that creation story, a man was made, and out of this man's last rib, a female was made, and then they were allowed to live in the Garden of Eden. They could live there for all of eternity as long as they didn't eat any of the fruit from the tree of knowledge. One day, the evil one there, the negative deity, went up to this woman and said, hey, you know what, Eve? I don't know if he said it that way, but hey, guess what, Eve? That one up there doesn't want you to know what he knows. And if you go and eat, take a fruit from the tree of knowledge, you'll know as much as him. And that females didn't want to have anything to do with that, and said to this evil, and he said, oh, was, punehen, means get away, leave me alone. I don't know if she said that, but something like that. But finally, this one here, this evil one, was convincing and convinced her to go take a fruit from the tree of knowledge, and she went and took an apple from the tree of knowledge, then took it back to the man and told the man, hey, guess what? I don't know if she said that, but something like that. Guess what I got? And she showed him the apple, and the man was just horrified, and I don't know if he was really, but something along that line, and said, why did you do that? And of course, she couldn't go put it back. She convinced him also to take a bite of the fruit from the tree of knowledge, this apple. So they both took a bite, and then the positive deity over there got really mad and went looking around for them all over the place. And then they finally found them hiding in a bush, and they were cowering in there. And he got really angry, and he said, You have broken my law. I told you never eat any of the fruit from the tree of knowledge. For this, I'm going to banish you from the Garden of Eden forever. And you, he pointed like that at the woman. He said, I'm gonna remind you of your, this is a sin you made. I'm gonna remind you of this terrible sin for all of eternity. And he gave her a menstrual cycle. He cursed her. So from that perspective, the menstrual cycle is known as a curse. From our perspective here, the menstrual cycle is considered a blessing. So you can see why these diametrically opposed views have a problem with one another. Number 28 is very symbolic and significant, and it all has to do with, again, the heuristic methodology. These are the major markers here. There are these minor markers which are frequently known as consonants. So that's what this man said his name was when we started. That's how I would write it using that writing system. Please don't say anything. Any of the rest of you that were here at the beginning, do you remember what he said his name was? Does anybody remember? Those of you that were here, I'll give you a hint. It started with me. Nobody? See, it's hard to switch the brain, and it's very difficult when you're learning words from another language. He said his name was Mi Guan. That's how you write it. Mi Guan. It means feather. Mi Guan is what he said his name was. I was talking about these ones here. This one says Ohkum. Ohkum. Now, there's my grandmother over there. What would I say to her? I would say, if I were, oh, this is wrong here. It actually goes Ohkum. I would say to her, Ninohkum, Ninohkum. Or else, if I wanted to straighten it out. That's another thing about the Nahio language, we're losing a syllable per generation. It used to be, Ninohkum is how I would address my grandmother over there. And now today it's Nohkum. Now, this gentleman here is telling me, saying, asking me, is that really your grandmother? And he would say to me, Kikuhkum, Kikuhkum. That's what this says, Kikuhkum, grandmother. Kikuhkum tiana, is that your grandmother? So, Kuhkum is somebody else's grandmother. And then, of course, the third person obviative. Ohkuma. Ohkuma. And so now he's going to go talk about me to that gentleman behind him. He's pointing at her with his finger and pointing his lips at me. And he'll say, Reuben Anneha Ohkuma. So that's the third person objective there. Are there any questions so far before carry on? Any comments?
I have a question about Miguan. What was Miguan writing again?
Miguan?
Yeah, Miguan.
Miguan. That's this one right here.
Okay.
That's what this says.
Was he writing on this? Was he a spirit writer on the rock?
This one here, it says Miguan. Mm-hmm. That's what this says.
Okay.
Miguan. Just like.
Did you do spirit markers on the rocks? Is my question.
Who?
Miguan.
That first symbol that you wrote.
Yeah.
Oh, this one here, you're talking about this one.
Yeah. Did he do that symbol on the rocks?
Did who do it? No, nobody knows. No, Miigwetch is this man here.
Oh, okay.
You've been around.
He wasn't there 10,000 years ago, I don't think. See, that's...
And, it was James Adams that interpreted the, translated the Bible.
Yeah, that's the thing. If you don't follow the thing, if you're on your text messaging thing, and
right.
you'll lose. Ohkum, that's the morpheme grandmother. Ohkum, that is the morpheme. So from granny, now this is Ninohkum, my granny. Kikuohkum, your granny. Oh, that's another one too. And this is placed above the syllabic to stress its vowel. Well, I'm merely doing that to stress the vowel. There's two dots in that with the consonants. There's one that's a W and one that's a stressed vowel. And I'm gonna get to that. Very good question. In a little bit here. As Ed was saying, the Edmonton Center for Race and Culture, what did you call it? Let me start it. The name he gave us was something different. We offer this through our programs from, they'll be going from September till next March. We'll have a 4-month session from September to December for, on Mondays and Wednesdays, there'll be 2-hour classes from 6:30 to 8:30, and on Tuesdays and Thursdays as well, there'll be 2-hour classes from 6:30 to 8:30. And we had done some research about retaining language, and it's the bare minimum that you can, that's somewhat realistic to retain a language is 2 hours twice a week. Of course, more would be better. More time would be better if you wanted to learn a language, but the bare minimum is 2 hours twice a week, according to research. So yes, this will be, we offer this at the Edmonton Center for Race and Culture, and our location will be at the St. Alphonsus School, which is at 2481 Street.
I was going to ask you a question, like from the different nations. Do they, are there some symbols that are very similar to the other nations?
I don't know. I met a Inuk lady, and she showed me her language system, and it was linear, and there were some similar patterns to our letters. I don't know about the other nations. Amiskwaciy waskahegan. Amiskwaciy waskahegan. Amiskwaciy waskahegan. Are there any other comments, questions?
Does it take very long to learn this syllabic form of writing?
I don't know. You were a student of mine. I've forgotten your name. What is it again? Rihanna, did you complete it? Did you master the chart?
I went to a master, but I remember the chart.
She knew the chart and she knew the system, and you were there for 3-4 months, twice a week, 2 hours. That's my guarantee, is that when you come into this program that you'll master that chart. I guarantee that. And you'll know how to articulate and sound like a native speaker. That's my other guarantee. For instance, a lot of people think that saying how in Nehyo means hi or hello. It doesn't. And the way you say how is this way. Tanese. Tanese. I'm going to go around the room here and ask you to repeat after me. Just say that as loud as you could. Tanese.
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 Yes. Very good. Some of you have that natural tendency for that. See, when you're saying that ta sound is not. Again, when I was talking about some specific consonant sounds, one of them is that ta sound. When I'm doing that, what sound I'm pressing my tongue up against the roof of my mouth, just above my teeth, and doing it firmly, and then doing a glottal stop, and then I push the air through and go ta, tanese. And so those sounds cannot be represented by the English alphabet, irrespective of diphthongs. The other one is, so ta, di, tu, te, those ones. And the other one is pa, pi, pu, pe. For instance, if I were to say laugh, I would say pa, pe, pa, pe. Can you say that? Yes.
Pa.
Pa pe. Say that.
Pa pe. Pa pe. Pa pe.
Very good. Oh, some of you came prepared. I like that. Those sounds, again, that pa sound doesn't exist. What I'm doing, I have my teeth apart about that much, and I'm pressing my lips firmly together, pa, pa, pa.